Hi everyone, today is 25th of January and I welcome you all to the Hindu Plus initiative, in which we are going to cover all the important articles of Hindu along with the relevant articles in PIB, Indian Express, Down to Earth, etc. And also I would like to tell you that you can download the synoptic notes of this entire session from the Telegram channel. Link for Telegram is given in description box in YouTube. And also I would like to clarify one thing, that the format which was being used earlier for the notes, that same format is being retained now also. Fine. So you can go and check out where one page, one notes format we have adopted. Now, moving on, guys. So first of all, in the today's session, what we are going to cover? First of all, we are going to take the quotation which you can use for the GS paper as well as the essay paper. Then we also have the current affair based MCQ questions. And then these are the articles we are going to cover for mains examination, free movement regime, GS paper number 2, IR, providing clean water for all, social justice and developmental issue, GS paper number 2, India Maldives quiet diplomacy, GS paper number 2, IR, world court and genocide, GS paper number 2, IR. Okay, and then these are the articles for the prelims, Pradhan Mantri Suryodaya Yojana, Kumkis, 3-drug regimen for leprosy, and for mapping, today we are going to see Senegal Lake Retba. So, let's get started with the today's articles. Now, first of all guys, practice MCQs for today. And I would insist that everybody please participate in this and leave your answers in the comment box. These MCQs we take on the basis of current articles that we have already discussed. So first article that we are, first question that we have for today is with respect to military exercises, Samudra Shakti, Indonesia, Varun exercise, France, exercise Cyclone, Egypt, exercise Khanjar, Kyrgyzstan. Choose the correct options. So identify correct option and please leave your answer in the comment box. We have discussed these particular exercises recently. Then next, consider the following statement with respect to design linked incentive scheme. So it comes under Ministry of Commerce. And the second is, it offers financial incentive and design infrastructure support. Choose the correct option. Fine, leave your answer in the comment box. Then next is, consider the following statements regarding the recent news. In the border states of West Bengal and Punjab, BSF operational jurisdiction is limited to 2 kilometers. Seema Sahastrabal SSB dealt with the boundary between India, Bhutan and India, Nepal. So if you remember, we have discussed that recently under Article 131 of the Constitution, Punjab has approached the Supreme Court and West Bengal also has certain confrontations, problems with respect to BSF. So please attempt this particular question. Now, moving on guys, and let's take the quotation for today. So today we are going to take quotation from the Alexis de Tocqueville. So he says, nothing is more wonderful than the art of being free, but nothing is harder to learn how to use that freedom. So we always appreciate the freedoms, okay? But often what happens, in the name of freedom, we want a license. But always freedoms will come with a reasonable restriction. And you have to learn that what is the domain of these reasonable restriction. One's freedoms and liberties have to be balanced with restriction, because absolute freedoms without restrictions will mean nobody's freedom. So the art of learning how to use that freedom is the most important one. You can use this particular idea in GS paper number 2, GS paper number 2, issues related to governance, as well as in essay GS paper number 4, and sorry, essay and ethics GS paper number 4, you can use this particular quotation. So this is guys all about it, and now let's move. Also guys, one more thing that we have left with last few seats with respect to our Roundup 2024 current affairs batch, which is going to be a dedicated batch for upcoming prelims examination current affairs section. In this particular module, we are going to cover entire last 1 year's current affairs in theme-based manner. We are going to cover current affairs in themes such as environment, economy, science and technology, art and culture, social justice and polity, international bodies. Also, along with these particular themes, we are going to cover the world mapping, the places that were in news that would also be taken. And also, in order to ensure the better understanding, after every few topics, we are going to take the MCQ questions also. So, to ensure that there is effective revision. Also, guys, I would like to tell you that this particular classes are going to be in the live form. However, if you have missed the live batch, you can watch recording later also, and validity of this particular course is 1 year. course is going to get started from 31st of January, okay, 31st of the January. In starting, there will be two classes per week, and then gradually we might shift to 3 to 4 classes per week if there is a need. And this particular batch will go till April, so that latest coverage with respect to current affairs you can get. So if you wish to complete the entire last 1 year's current affair, you can join this particular batch by scanning this QR code, or you can visit our website, that is www.sahilsaini.net, and from there you can enroll in this particular module. Okay, so that is about it. And now guys, let's discuss the first article for today. Reconsidering the free movement regime. Reconsidering the free movement regime. Now this particular article we are going to cover with respect to GS paper number 2, India-Myanmar issues, as well as with respect to India and issues pertaining to Northeast, we are going to cover this particular article. Now, before going in this particular article, let's see certain basic background information first. So guys, here you can see that we have the map of Myanmar. And when we talk about Myanmar, India shares a border of 1,643 kilometers with Myanmar. And please tell me in the comment box that which is the country with which India shares the largest or the longest border. So, with the Myanmar, we shares 1,643 kilometer border. Now, this particular border is shared by the states Mizoram, fine, Manipur, Nagaland and Arunachal Pradesh. Okay, Mizoram, Manipur, Nagaland and Mizoram. And when we talk about the longest border is shared by Arunachal Pradesh. Now, understand this particular thing, guys, that when we talk about India and Myanmar shared a very deep relation because of the historical ties that have been there between India and Myanmar. Now, why these historical ties are there? Let's understand this particular thing. So basically, guys, understand that Treaty of Yandubu was signed in 1826. And this particular treaty led to the end of First Burmese War. First Anglo-Burmese War. Now, after the Treaty of Yandubu, what happened? The current alignment of boundary between India and Burma, Myanmar, came in existence. Now, understand this particular thing. Before the Treaty of Yandubu, this entire region was the part of Burmese Empire, Burmese Kingdom. But after the Treaty of Yandubu, it got divided. It got divided in two parts. However, people living in this side as well as this side, they have deep ethnic ties, they have matrimonial ties, they have cultural ties. Okay. So what has happened? There was an understanding that these people should be allowed to intermingle with each other. Okay. Now, when we talk about guys, India and Myanmar, understand this particular thing. Free movement regime was created between India and Myanmar, which came in existence in 2018 as the part of India's Act East policy. So as a part of Act East policy, India wants to integrate to the South Eastern countries and the Northeast of India. It is to be integrated with countries such as Myanmar, Thailand, likewise. And in this particular capacity, what happened? We came out with the Act East policy. Now, as per this free movement regime, what happened? It allowed the people who are living on the either side of the border. So the people living on the either side of the border, they can travel. They can travel in the each other's territory. For example, people living in Myanmar, they enter in India up till 16 kilometer. They enter in India up till 16 kilometer. And for that particular thing, they need not to have a visa. Without a visa, they can visit. Also this, for this particular movement, there will be a pass that will be given. And this particular border pass will be valid for one particular year. Okay. Now, also through this free movement regime, we envisaged to improve the local border trade, localized border trade. Fine, which will revive the economy or which will further improve the economy in this particular region. Also, what happened? Designated markets by the name of HATS, they were also developed. Okay, so this was the free movement regime that got created between India and Myanmar. Also, guys, when we talk about between India and Myanmar, because of the rough terrain, a large part of boundary is also not it is not feasible that you can fence that particular boundary. Now, what happened? Recently, Home Minister he said this particular thing, that 1643 kilometer boundary that is there between India and Myanmar, it will now be fenced. It will now be fenced. A fence will be erected and this free movement regime will come to an end, or we will reconsider. We will reconsider, and if we found that it is not serving the intended purpose, that would be end. Because of this particular thing, multiple state governments, they have different responses. For example, when we talk about the Mizoram and Nagaland, they are opposed to ending the free movement regime. Why they are opposed to ending free movement regime? Because of the ethnic cultural ties that are there. But some of the states such as Manipur, they have said this particular thing, that this free movement regime should end. Now, why free movement regime should end? Basically, it has been provided that because of this free movement regime, what has happened, there is a lot of inward trafficking of drugs that is happening. Drugs from Myanmar are coming in India. Also, what has happened, there is outward trafficking of wildlife body parts that are happening. Okay, so it has been provided. For example, guys, you might be knowing that in the Kaziranga National Park, there is one horn rhino's population that is there, and the one horn rhino has often been hunted because of their horns, and many other body parts of other animals, they also have been extracted and they have been exported to countries, particularly such as China, and that movement happens through the Myanmar, and this free movement regime, which provides the unrestricted access towards both of the sites, it has been made responsible. Also, guys, if you might already be knowing this particular thing, that what happened recently, there was a Manipur crisis got started. And it has been said that basically what has happened, a lot of Myanmar people have come, and they are also responsible for the law and order problem. They are also important, responsible for the law and order problem. So because of these particular things, it has been said that the free movement regime should come to an end. But guys, if we put an end, so what might happen? There might be again a kind of a resentment that might develop specifically between the Naga people, okay, as well as the Kuki-Chin Mizo community. Because the Naga people and Kuki-Chin Mizo community, they share a lot of ethnic ties with the people living towards the side of Myanmar. So this is the free movement regime. However, up till now, it has not been a clarity that whether it will be ended or will not be ended. Government had said that we will reconsider it. So we need to see that what will be the government move in this particular direction in the times to come. Okay, so if a question comes, let's say free movement regime was recently in use, it is in between which two countries? India, Bangladesh, India, Myanmar, India, Bhutan. So India, Myanmar is the right option. Now, moving to the next article, So the article is providing clean water to all. Now, this particular article we are going to see with respect to GS paper number 2, social justice. Okay. Now, this particular article is actually talking about Jal Jeevan Mission. Now, what is Jal Jeevan Mission? Jal Jeevan Mission is government's one of a flagship program which aims to provide minimum 55 liters of water to every individual by 2024. It aims to provide functional household tap connections by 2024. Okay, and how much water? 55 liter per capita per day. Also, water is not to be provided. There needs to be reliability, that is, water should be regular, water should be safe, should be free from contaminants, okay, equity and inclusivity, no one should be left behind. Often what happens, poor sections or people of particular religion, particular caste, they are left behind. That should not happen. Quality should be there, affordability, user charges if are being given for the water, they should not be unaffordable. Sustainability, okay. For example, often what has been done in order to get the water, groundwater has been tapped, which leads to declining water table. So such kind of thing should not be there. So we find that these are the six pillars of Jal Jeevan Mission. Now, Jal Jeevan Mission, it aligns with the Sustainable Developmental Goal number 6. which talks about providing the clean water access to people. Okay. Now, basically, article is talking about success of Jal Jeevan Mission. Okay, and as per the article, it is being provided that as per the status report of the Jal Jeevan Mission, it is going in a very good capacity, and 73% of the rural households in India, they have been provided the piped water connection, and it seems that goal of 100% piped water connections will be realized soon. Also, it has been provided that we are moving in the direction of the SDG goal number 6 also. Moreover, this particular Jal Jeevan Mission does not works on the one size fit all approach, because you see, different regions have different type of water problems. Okay, so customized, tailor made solutions have been brought to ensure water availability in every nook and corner of the country. Also, it has, for example, we see that in the cold regions, for example, if you go towards Himachal Pradesh, Jammu Kashmir, Uttarakhand, there often water gets frozen in the pipes. So how water is being provided here? Insulated pipes are being used in the hilly as well as the cold regions. Okay, often we find this particular thing that in villages with water quality issue, multi-village scheme through bulk water transfers are being planned. Good quality bulk transfers are being planned. Okay, also what has happened in the places where water quality is unacceptable or it is not in the safe limits, there the community-led purification plants, community-led water purification plants are being provided, because not only water quantity is to be ensured, but the quality of water has to be ensured. Also, guys, in this particular capacity, it has been provided that providing the sanitation, providing clean water has multiplier effects. Now here, according to the Nobel laureate, Dr. Michael Kramer, in his study, he finds this particular thing that providing safe water can reduce infant deaths by almost 30%. Infant mortality rate could be reduced by 30%, and it has further potential to prevent 25% of the under 5 deaths in India. Right now, there are 1,36,000 children who die before the age of 5. 25% of them would be saved just by providing the clean water. So this is an affordable and a very good intervention that should be made, and government is moving in this direction through Jal Jeevan Mission. Also, this intervention will have economic benefits also. And in this capacity, there is a study conducted by the World Health Organization. According to the WHO, every year by providing the clean water, 4 lakh deaths which happened because of the diarrhea, they can be prevented. 4 lakh deaths could be averted. Now, also guys, understand, it has been provided that it might lead to economic savings of up to $101 billion. Now, a question might come in your mind that how it will lead to economic savings. So let's understand this particular thing. Now guys, see, today what is happening? Large number of people, particularly the women, they have to go kilometers and kilometers just to fetch water. Now, this takes substantial part of their day. And because of this activity, they cannot participate in any economic activity. Okay, they are not able to become the part of the labor force. Female labor force participation rate has declined. We have so much of young demography. But what is the benefit of this young population, young demography? They cannot contribute in economically productive activities. And often the time is getting wasted in things such as fetching the water. So providing them the pipe drinking water can save millions and millions of man working hours, which could be contributed towards the economy. Also, what happens? As these many deaths are happening, this is the productive demographic dividend that we are losing every year. So as it would be saved, again, it will lead to the economic benefits. And such economic benefits are more than $100 billion, around $101 billion, as per the study done by the World Health Organization. Guys, please use these particular data in your answers. Also, it has been provided that this initiative is not only providing the water, but is also leading to capacity building. For example, as a part of the Jal Jeevan Mission, Nal Jal Mitra initiative has also been started. Now, what is this Nal Jal Mitra initiative? Understand this thing. Suppose piped connections are being provided. There are the village-based water purification plants that are being provided. Okay. Fine, such things are there. Now, they will need maintenance. They will need repairing. So, for maintenance and repairing, local community are being trained so that they can repair that, and in turn, they can earn some wages. So, Nal Jal Mitra initiative, what will be done? Comprehensive set of skills will be provided to the people so that they can carry out the minor repairs. They can carry the maintenance of the piped water supply. And in this capacity, capacity building is done. Also, what has happened, there are 5.29 lakh village water and sanitation committees, Pani Samitis, have been constituted, which in a decentralized manner are going to deal with the issues of water, sanitation, etc. So this is an example of grassroots democracy, grassroots participation that is being promoted by Jal Jeevan Mission, that is the Pani Samitis. Also, this particular project, in order to ensure efficiency, timeliness and transparency in this particular project, a digital dashboard has also been created. So there is a Jal Jeevan Mission dashboard, and this Jal Jeevan Mission dashboard, what it does, it gives the real time updates. What it does, it gives the real time updates with respect to the progress report, for example, that how many households have been connected with the piped drinking water, which villages have not been connected, which states are lacking behind. So all this particular data is being provided by these progress reports. Also what happened, Department of Drinking Water and Sanitation, it also maintains water quality checks so that arsenic, fluorides, etc., their level, contaminants level can be controlled, okay? As well as they also ensure that if there is some contamination, there should be corrective action that should be taken, and effective grievance redressal should be there, because water is a basic necessity, okay? So all these are the success points of Jal Jeevan Mission. Now, understand one particular thing. In your GS paper number 2, governance and social justice is mentioned, and there specifically working of the government schemes, critical evaluation of the government schemes and initiative has been mentioned there. So guys, there a question on this particular line can be asked, and also understand that 2024 is the year till which 100% water connections were to be provided, and this year that deadline is coming to the near because we are in 2024, so high probability area for question. Fine, so that is about it. And now moving to the next article. The World Court and Genocide. Now this particular article, guys, we are going to see with respect to GS paper number 2, International Affairs and International Issues. Now guys, before going in this particular article, we are again going to see some basic background as we do every time. So first of all, let me tell you context of this particular article. So what has happened? Recently, South Africa has approached the ICJ, International Court of Justice. Why? Because South Africa says that Israel is carrying systematic killings in Gaza Strip, and these killings are the part of genocide that Israel has started. Now, understand this particular thing, that there is 1948 genocide convention, and this particular conventions provide that all the states are obliged to not to commit the genocide as well as to punish genocide. Now what is genocide as per this 1948 genocide convention? According to it, genocides are acts committed with intent to destroy in whole or in part national, ethnical, racial or religious groups. So when deliberately a state is trying to kill, terminate some religious group, ethnical group, okay, racial group, religious group, that attempt is called as genocide. Now understand, this genocide convention came because of the Holocaust that was carried by the Nazis during the World War II. So Nazis deliberately and systematically, they tried to eliminate Jew community. So in response to that, this genocide convention was brought. Now what is happening? Israel is carrying attacks against Hamas. Now Hamas's stronghold is in Gaza Strip. Now as they have carried the attack on Hamas, they have killed thousands and thousands of children, women, innocent people who had nothing to do with the war. So basically, it is being said by the South Africa that they are not just trying to eliminate Hamas, they are trying to carry on the systematic killing of the Palestinian people. So it is a kind of a genocide. So ICJ should issue the order to Israel to immediately suspend its military operations in the Gaza Strip. So for this particular thing, South Africa has approached ICJ and they have filed the complaint against Israel. Okay. Now, let's discuss the basic aspects of this particular article. Now, in this particular direction, what has happened? The case has generated debate. Now the world countries are divided. Some of them are supporting Israel, some of them are supporting the South Africa. For example, Bangladesh, Jordan, countries in Middle East, okay, countries in Middle East, they have supported largely South Africa. However, European countries, particularly Germany, United States, UK, France, they have said that they are going to support Israel. And France particularly had even said this thing, that if ruling came against Israel, then France will not be adhering with ICJ's any order, okay, International Court of Justice's order. Now, when we understand this particular thing, guys, we see that genocide, it has been treated as the most serious of the international crimes. And in the past, many other countries have also filed the case in genocide's direction. For example, what happened? Recently, Gambia, it instituted proceedings against the Myanmar. Now, you know this thing that in 2021, coup happened in Myanmar and military junta has come to the power. And after that, they have committed a lot of atrocities on the Rohingya Muslims in Myanmar. And it is being said that this is the part of genocide which is being carried by Myanmar on Rohingya. So therefore, Gambia filed a complaint against the Myanmar. Now guys, you just see double standards of the European country. And here we are going to take the example of Germany. So see this particular thing, that when case was filed by Gambia against Myanmar, Germany supported Gambia. And Germany said this particular thing, that genocide convention should be interpreted more liberally and Myanmar should be punished. Okay. But now what they are doing, they have taken the opposite stand. Now they are saying that genocide convention cannot be interpreted that liberally. Israel should not be punished. But earlier the same Germany was saying that it should be interpreted liberally. So it shows the double standards also of European countries. Now understand this particular thing, that in this particular case, what might happen? As of now, some final ruling has not come. But you see, basically, if you have to prove that a genocide is being committed, you have to demonstrate the specific intention. Now, what has happened? South Africa has said that from the speeches given by the leaders of Israel and military commanders of Israel, it could be inferred that they want to carry the Palestinian people. They want to carry the Palestinian people. But still, there is a high threshold. You have to prove, or you have to provide a conclusive proof. But that conclusive proof as of now has not been given. Now understand what South Africa is asking. South Africa is asking for the provisional measures. Now what is provisional measures? Provisional measure is some interim direction that is given till the time final judgment does not come. So let's say final judgment will come some days or weeks time. Till that, they want some provisional measures, some interim judgment. Fine. But understand this thing, as of now, nothing much has happened. Also, when we talk about ICJ, there is one practical limitation of ICJ also. See, ICJ's ruling is binding, okay, but at the same time, ICJ does not have any mechanism to get its ruling enforced. Even in the context of Russia-Ukraine, ICJ has very clearly given this particular ruling that the war should be suspended, but nothing has happened in this capacity. Okay, now a question might be coming in your mind, that war is going on between Israel and Hamas. Why Hamas has not been called in the International Court of Justice? Why nobody filed a case against ICJ? Why the case is being filed against Israel? So understand this particular thing, guys, that ICJ cannot be brought to the International Court of Justice. Why? Because it is a non-state actor. Hamas officials are the non-state actor. Okay. If you want to bring some of the Hamas's officials, you can bring them into the ICC, International Criminal Court, but not in ICJ. So here what we are going to see, the difference between ICJ and ICC, International Court of Justice and International Criminal Court. So first of all, International Court of Justice. Yes. So when we talk about the International Court of Justice, ICJ, it was established in 1946. International Criminal Court was established in 2002. Okay. When we talk about the ICJ, International Court of Justice, it is official court of the United Nations. And because of that, it is also called as the World Court. But ICC, it is an independent body which came in existence by Rome Statute. which came in existence by Rome statute. It is not a UN body. But United Nations can refer the cases to ICC, but it is not a UN body. Okay. Then location, Hague, Netherlands, and ICC's location is also Hague, Netherlands. Now, what types of cases ICJ take? International Court of Justice takes the cases against the state parties. Against the state parties. Okay. And ICC, it takes the criminal prosecutions of individuals. So, individuals are taken under ICC and the state parties are taken under the ICJ. And subject matters, fine, sovereignty, boundary issues, maritime disputes, trade, natural resources, human right violation, treaty violation, okay, genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes. In fact, genocide will come here also. Why? Because under the cases of the human right, cases of the treaties, it will come. Okay, funding, it is UN funded, fine, here the funding, okay, voluntary contribution, if UN can, wants, can provide it, okay. So this is the difference between the these two bodies. So coming back, so a question, if it comes in your mind that why Hamas is not being called, because Hamas is a non-state actor, and in ICJ only the state actors, state parties can be brought. All the members of the UN are the members of the ICJ also. But in the past, we have seen that United Nations and in fact ICJ has become a toothless organization, because on ground nothing is being done by these particular organizations effectively. Okay, so that is all guys about this particular article. And now moving on in next article. Limits and borders. Now, this particular article. Okay. Now, this particular article, it is about India-Maldives relations. This particular article is with respect to India-Maldives relations. India-Maldives relations. Okay. Now, guys, recently what has happened, India-Maldives relations have got declined to a considerable low level. Now, why India-Maldives relations got declined and whether there is some kind of a positive thing coming in this particular direction, yes or no? And what is this quiet diplomacy that we often hear in the news? All these particular things we are going to cover in this particular article. So basically, guys, what has happened? You might be knowing that recently presidential elections happened in Maldives, and with this presidential election, Mr. Muizzu became new president of Maldives. And Mr. Muizzu was the supporter of India Out campaign. India Out campaign. Former president of Maldives, Mr. Ibu Soli, he was sympathetic to India. And former president of Maldives, that is Mr. Soli, he came out with India First policy. He came out with India First policy. And in opposition to India First, Mr. Muizzu came out with India Out policy. India Out policy. And as he won election, it was very logical that he is going to follow the policies which are against India and he will be more pro-China. Okay. And the same thing he has started after that. We have seen that first of all, there was a tussle over the Indian troops that are stationed in Maldives. These troops helps Maldives to operate the Dornier aircraft that has been given by India and the helicopters that have been given by India. So it was asked that the Indian troops have to be removed. Okay. Second, suspension of hydrographic surveys. So hydrographic surveys were started after 2019, and these hydrographic surveys give information about the ocean profile and help in better navigation, safe navigation of ships, traffic, etc. Okay. Derogatory remarks by Maldivian minister. So what happened recently, Prime Minister of India visited Lakshadweep, and as he visited Lakshadweep, certain derogatory comments were made by Maldivian ministers. Because of that, in India, there was a social media backlash that also happened. So these things show how the situation between India and Maldives have become problematic. And recently what has happened, there is a Chinese research vessel, Chinese research ship by the name of Xiang Yang Hong 03. Okay. Now this particular ship, it is expected to reach Maldives. It is expected to reach Maldives around the month of February. Around the month of the February. And there are the reports that this particular ship will dock in Maldives. Now, what has happened? This particular ship is a surveillance ship, and the concern that this particular ship might collect some of the sensitive information which might impact the Indian interest. So basically, this research vessel Xiang Yang Hong 03, which is expected to dock in Maldives, India is seeing as again one of a policy of anti-India. Okay, now basically guys, what has happened, this particular, basically the Chinese research vessel, it also aimed to visit Sri Lanka last year, but again at that point of a time also there was a backlash that happened, and Colombo banned that from 2024 all the foreign research ships that are believed to collect the data or military or civilian purposes will not be docked in Sri Lanka. So this is one of a good example that how India convinced one of a neighbor with respect to the security concerns of India, and Sri Lanka aligned. But now it is the Maldives which is believed to allow this particular ship to dock in Maldives, and it has again become a new flashpoint between India and Maldives. Now understand this particular thing. Understand this particular thing, that when we talk about the situation right now, it has become quite complicated, and because of the social media activism also the situation has declined. But it is a maturity of Indian diplomacy that they are still continuing the talks with Maldives. For example, what happened, though this concerns got started already in the month of December, so Prime Minister still met Mr. Muizu, on the lines of the COP, and bilateral negotiations were also taken up in this particular capacity. Also guys, what has happened recently, Mr. S. Jaishankar has met his Maldivian counterpart recently. So all these particular things show that there are still talks that are going on between India and Maldives. Now, as these particular talks are going on, this is a very good thing, because you need to understand the condition of both India and Maldives at the same time. First of all, when we talk about India, India is a regional power aspiring to become a superpower. And in this particular capacity, India cannot afford to be seen as a country which is trying to arm twist its small neighbors. India want to show a compassionate, India want to show a generous heart in this particular direction. So therefore, India cannot be afforded to seen as a hegemon power, cannot be afforded to be seen as a nation which has an attitude of big brother. Okay, but at the same time, if we talk about Maldives, Maldives is a very small economy. It depends on India for a large number of things. For example, tourist. We find this particular thing that last year, the largest number of tourists that came to Maldives after Russia were from India. Okay, so that is something which is important. Also, as Maldives is prone to climate change, sea level rise, India can support Maldives in medical, with respect to the disaster resilience. Okay, India has always supported Maldives. Also guys, in the past, India has supported Maldives from the coup. Okay, or has protected the Maldives from the coup. Okay, in also a lot of infrastructure projects have been taken by India in the Maldives. So India does not want to spoil this particular relation. So it is a compulsion for both the countries that they need each other. Recently also, what has happened, there was election that were conducted in Male for the position of mayor. And in this election, the political party of Mr. Muizu, they have lost. Also, upcoming parliamentary elections, the elections to Majlis, there also it has been seen that the approval rating of Mr. Muizu's political party is going down. So they don't want to spoil relations with the India. So what actually has happened? There is quite diplomacy that is at work. And guys, we see that what happened recently, Maldives had decided that they will see Xiang Yang Hong 3 ship that is coming, they will not allow it more than a routine port call. Okay, routine port call will be there. They will not provide them some logistic support. They will not allow them to dock for a long period of time. Just a port call will be allowed. So this shows that India has been able to convince Maldives with respect to its concerns, and Maldives is also seeing that. And it is an example of quiet diplomacy. It is an example of quiet diplomacy. Okay, what is quiet diplomacy? Quiet diplomacy is when, without too much pomp show, without too much public gaze, fine, through often backtrack diplomacy, countries negotiate and they are able to raise each other's concerns, and those are resolved peacefully. Okay, so this is this example, and this is a very good template that India should follow in other cases also. Moving to next article. Odisha knocks on Tamil Nadu's door to help tackle jumbo attacks, seeks for Kumki elephant and mahouts. Now, this article we have taken from Indian Express newspaper. So basically, guys, often in the news we have there are certain such things that are there, and they are asked in UPSC examination also. For example, Khrai camel has already been asked by the UPSC. Okay, and many such kind of a things, such species, etc., that are in news, they are asked. So today we are going to see the Kumki. So basically, what are the Kumki? So basically, these are specialized, trained captive elephants that are used for trapping, rescuing, and tranquilize other wild elephants. So often what happens, elephants, they go rogue, they kill people, they spoil the crop, okay, they enter into the human habitations and they wreak a lot of havoc. Okay, such wild elephants are there. These wild elephants have to be tamed. Otherwise, there will be the man-animal conflict that will happen. And man-animal conflict happens to be one very big concern with respect to wildlife in India. So basically, to tame, to control these wild elephants, another elephants are used. And these elephants are called as the Kumki elephants. So what are these Kumki elephants? These are trained elephants which are used to trap, rescue, and neutralize the other wild elephants. Now these Kumki elephants, they are trained for a period of 6 to 8 years, and with the help of these Kumki elephants, Tamil Nadu has been able to neutralize a lot of wild animals, elephants, and now Odisha wants the help of Tamil Nadu. So what has happened? In order to mitigate this man-elephant conflict, okay, Odisha has requested 4 Kumki elephants as well as their mahouts. Mahouts are the people, trained people who control these elephants. Okay, mahouts. Fine. So 4 elephants and their mahouts. Okay, they have been requested by Odisha from Tamil Nadu. And Tamil Nadu has an example of success in training and utilizing such elephants for wildlife conservation. Okay, so this is something. Also, these particular elephants, they can be deployed for forest patrolling. They can be deployed for rescue operations. Okay, so this is something that has been there. And also, this is an example of state-to-state cooperation in the areas of conservation. State-to-state cooperation in the areas of conservation. Okay, that is about it. The next article. Okay, now, this article was specifically for prelims examination. This article is also for the prelims examination. Okay, so article reads, Prime Minister chairs a meeting to launch Pradhan Mantri Suryodaya Yojana with the target of installing rooftop solar on 1 crore houses. Now, this particular scheme, it aims to reduce electricity bill of the poor and middle classes along with making India self-reliant in energy sector. Now, let's understand some basic background information first, and then we'll go in the detail of this particular article. Okay. Now, guys, what has happened? India, in COP26, that was held in Glasgow, came out with Panch Amrit goals. And as a part of these Panch Amrit goal, India provided that India will become carbon neutral nation by 2070. India will become carbon neutral nation by 2070. Also, in this particular direction, it was provided that 500 gigawatt of electricity will come by renewables by 2030. By 2030, 50% of India's installed electricity, 50% of India's energy, 50% of India's energy requirements will come from the renewable energy. Fine, in this particular capacity, guys, solar energy becomes a very, very important avenue. So, for example, if you want to become carbon neutral, what is to be a carbon neutral nation? Carbon neutrality means that carbon emissions that are being emitted and the, carbon emissions that are being emitted as well as the carbon that is being absorbed, that should be balanced. Right now, we are carbon neutral. We emit more carbon. And because of that, there is climate change that is happening. So we aim to become carbon neutral by 2070. How that can happen? For that, more and more renewable energy is to be deployed. Now, India, when we talk about guys, India, you know this particular thing that, you know, this particular thing, that Tropic of Cancer. We know this particular thing that the Tropic of Cancer, it divides the country in two parts. And as a Tropic of Cancer divides country in two parts, a substantial part of India comes into the tropical belt. And we know this thing because of that, India has abundant sunshine. So we want to utilize that particular sunlight more. As of now, guys, what has happened? Government has developed solar parks, which are huge facilities generating the solar electricity. But now we want to ensure that even the households should have rooftop solar plants. Now, already, guys, in 2014, government has come out with the solar rooftop program. In 2014, solar rooftop program, government already announced, in which incentives would be provided to the households, commercial entities, that they deploy the solar panels on their roofs. Okay, excess electricity they can even sell. But what about poor people? Now, guys, if you see poor people, they face a situation, for example, number one, they many number of times don't have electricity connection. Even let's say if they are provided the electricity connection, what happens? They are not able to pay electricity bill because electricity is often very, because of the expensive nature of electricity. So what can be done? If poor people on their households, solar panels are deployed, rather than paying for electricity, they can make their own electricity by the sunshine. So number one, they will get affordable, accessible electricity. Number two, that will contribute towards the renewable energy. And if they make some excess electricity, that excess electricity could be traded also. So what has happened? Now Prime Minister in this capacity has come out with the Pradhan Mantri Suryodaya Yojana. Now this Pradhan Mantri Suryodaya Yojana aims to provide rooftop solar panels, fine, and 1 crore households or 1 crore families, they will be provided the rooftop solar energy. Now here the focus would be done on the poor and middle income households, so that they can reduce the electricity bill and also excess electricity they can trade. So this is the aim of Pradhan Mantri Suryodaya Yojana. Okay, now guys, often in examination, questions on the schemes, etc. are asked, where they might ask that, okay, this XYZ scheme was recently in news. What is this scheme? So, please keep it in your mind. Suryodaya Yojana for providing rooftop solar plants to households, particularly middle and lower income group households. Now, moving on. Center releases 3-drug regimen for treating leprosy. Now, this particular article, again, we are going to see with respect to the prelims examination, because on diseases, etc., question has been asked in the past. Now, first of all, what is leprosy? So, guys, when we talk about leprosy is an infectious disease and it is caused by the Mycobacterium leprae. It is caused by the bacteria. Which bacteria? Mycobacterium leprae. And it is infectious disease. So person to person transmission happens. So when a person already infected by leprosy, when that particular person sneezes or coughs, then through the nose, mouth droplets, okay, or with the frequent contact with the person having leprosy, this particular bacteria, Mycobacterium leprae, it got transmitted and another person can get ill. Okay. Now guys, when we talk about leprosy often still contributes a huge disease burden. Okay. And in this capacity, India also has the large number of leprosy cases. Now, when we talk about guys leprosy, already government of India is running National Leprosy Eradication Program. And as the part of this National Leprosy Eradication Program, by 2027, leprosy is to be eradicated from India. But for that particular thing, there needs to be the targeted drug regimen that is to be provided. Continuous drugs are to be administered. And in this particular capacity, what has happened? WHO has approved multi-drug therapy. And now this multi-drug therapy would be given to the leprosy patients in India. leprosy patients in India. According to the government, this multi-drug therapy, it is based on globally accepted and scientifically researched studies and on the basis of evidence-based approach, this multi-drug therapy has been adopted. Now understand this thing. This multi-drug therapy contains three drugs. It contains three drugs, that is dapsone, okay, rifampicin, and clofazimine. Clofazimine. These three drugs are there in MDT, that is multi-drug therapy. Okay. Now, when we talk about the MDT, this MDT would be provided by WHO. WHO would provide it free of cost. Now, this MDT was earlier provided or funded by the Nippon Foundation, but since 2000, it has been donated through Novartis, which is a pharmaceutical company. So we will get this drug by WHO. It contains three of the drugs, dapsone, rifampicin, and then there is a clofazimine. Okay. So you need to keep these particular things in your mind, because the questions on such lines also have been asked in the past. So that is about it. And now moving to the next article. So this is the mapping article that we are going to take today. Now, guys, what has happened recently? Recently, Senegal's Pink Lake was in news. Okay. Now, what is this Senegal's Pink Lake? Why it is pink? What is the location of this lake? For the mapping part, we need to understand. First of all, the name of this lake is Lake Retba. And this Lake Retba, it is in Senegal. Northeast of Dakar. So guys, here we see that this is Senegal. Now, first of all, let's see the neighbors of Senegal. So Senegal is a country in Africa. Okay. And neighbors are, on the northern side, we have Mauritania. Then towards the eastern side, we have Mali. Okay. Then here we have, Guinea, okay, fine, okay, here we have Gambia, here we have Guinea-Bissau, okay, so these are the countries, Mauritania, Mali, Guinea-Bissau, and Gambia is in between, okay, and guys, here we have Gambia River, which passes in the mid of the Gambia River, Gambia country, okay, so from the mid of the Gambia, Gambia River passes. If you guys remember, we have seen today Gambia also. Why? Because Gambia filed a case against Myanmar for the Rohingya issue. Now, here on the, here we have Atlantic Ocean, so Senegal is, it has Atlantic Ocean towards its west. Now here there is the Dakar. Here we have Dakar. And on the northeast of Dakar, we find this pink lake. Now guys, let me show you this particular pink lake. Just a minute. Okay, so here you can see this pink lake. Now guys, when we talk about this pink lake of Senegal, literally it is pink in color, so there why the this particular name comes. And guys, when we talk about this particular lake, we find that it is bound by the sand dunes, and on this side we have ocean and here we have the pink lake. Okay, now the question comes that why this pink lake, first of all, is in news and why it is pink in color. So first of all, I hope that you have understood the location. Northeast of Dakar, which country is Senegal? Okay, and fine. So first of all, this particular pink lake, okay, it is isolated from the sea by sand dunes. I have shown you also. Now the water in this particular lake comes from the seasonal water table in the sand dunes. Now this particular lake has a high salinity because of its vicinity with the ocean. Also, when we talk about pink color of this particular lake, it is because of a particular type of algae that are found in this particular in this particular lake. And that is halophilic green algae. halophilic green algae, and then there is the Dunalila salina. Then there is the Dunalila salina. Now this particular Dunalila salina, it contains red pigments, and because of these red pigments, pink color is given to this particular lake. Now when we talk about Dunalila salina, it contains four antioxidant pigments, that is beta carotene, okay, then there is the extactin, then there is lutein, and then there is the zeaxanthin. Because of this, red color comes, and also it has a certain trace elements and rich vitamins also. Now there is one particular aspect of this pink lake that, see, sometimes it turns green also. So when salinity is high in this particular lake, algae with red pigments will thrive, and as the red pigment will thrive, color will turn pink. But when the salinity will come down, it will give way to the algae rich in green pigment. But as it is in the vicinity of the ocean, it has a huge salinity, and because of that particular salinity, fine, Dunalila salina thrives, which has red pigments, and because of that red pigments, pink color of this particular lake is there. Okay, so this was about it. I hope that you have understood. Also, one more thing is that this particular lake is also called as the lac rose lake, which means pink lake. So this is, guys, all about this particular article, and with this we come to an end to this particular session. Guys, I hope that you have liked this particular video, and I hope that you are appreciating the wide coverage that we are taking in this particular article. And actually, it takes a lot of effort every day to prepare these notes, to do the research, and to make the video. If you have liked the video, just please, I will request that you share the video, you hit the like button, and also please leave your lovely comments, because that is the only motivation for us for this initiative. Thank you so much. Now we'll be meeting.